Hello everyone, I am Metan Uzun. My teammates are Mert İstanuz and İdris Dağdelen. Our supervisor is Murat Karakaya. Today we will be present a final presentation of our project. Firstly, I want to mention about our dataset. We get this dataset on divendata.org. It's about flu shot learning. Our goal is predict who one will be vaccinated or not. Result of the project system will return us 0 or 1. 0 means that a person who did not get the seasonal vaccine. Otherwise, 1 means that a person who get the seasonal vaccine. Prediction is very important for our world because no matter how advanced the technology is, some disease occur in the world and we can overcome these disease thanks to vaccines. Snapshot of our data. At the start of this project, we have approximately 27K samples and 31 features. 12 of them categorical and 18 of them numeric value. In the statuses, there were two target feature, but we eliminate one of them. Our selected target is seasonal vaccines. Next. You can see summary next. You can see a summary of our data in this picture. Next. Our machine learning task is supervised learning because we have labeled input and output pairs. Since our results can be 0 or 1, that's why it is binary classification. As I said, 0 means that no, 1 means that yes. Next. In this table, you can see our features and their descriptions. Next.
Hi everyone, I am Mert İhsan. The distribution of the target feature is quite balanced, as seen in the diagram. There are 0 in the proximity of 14,000 and 1 in the proximity of 12,000. In here, the features with the deepest yellow, as you can see in here, are the most important target value. The most important is the opinion seasonal vaccine effective, and the other one, opinion seasonal risk and opinion seasonal sickness from vaccines, are the two more related features. In here, we use rank for the feature selection. We utilize the rank approach, and among the features, we have chosen 5 most crucial ones. It produced nearly identical findings, Pearson correlation.
Mert, I have a question, if you let me.
Yes, hocam.
Why 5? Why not 6, 7, 8, whatever? Why it's only 5? What's the magic in 5?
I just think it is can be enough, but we can increase that number also.
Do you have any justification for that?
No, John.
Or you just randomly select the 5 as the first 5. And on the left side, we have the scoring methods. And it seems that in your presentation, none of them is selected. Is that true?
You are true, John. Yes.
So actually, I think that you would like to select one of them or some of them, right?
Yes, hocam. Right. You will correct.
So, okay, please correct that. And of course, it's just if somebody's microphone is on, could you please turn it off? I think somebody's microphone is on. Yes. So, could you please try again and check that if any of them is information and information ratio, Gini, ANOVA, etc. This scoring method, you can use this and then select one of them or several of them. But there is no hard rules, hardcore rules saying that you need to select the first n number of the features, but it gives you an idea. Okay, for example, for the ANOVA, you would say that less than 0.5, we don't select this. That there is a justification for that. Do you follow me?
Yes, hocam. Hamdi.
So if you select a score, then in that score, you could set up a threshold to select the features. All right.
All right, hocam. We will correct that.
Okay, let's continue.
When we look at the variation values in PCI, the most important features about 0.54. And from here, as you can see, we look at specific number of log features and that have little influence at the draft feature operation. Based on our findings, we need...
Can I ask a question?
Yes,
so, did you provide the first five features that you mentioned in the previous slide?
No, hocam. All of the features.
So do you use the ranking or not? In the previous slide, you show us that you use the ranking. And then you selected the five features. Did you select these five features or not?
No, in here we use all of the features.
But in your model, in your final model, how did you choose the features?
Actually, we use
according to form. Ranking or say again?
A heat map, hocam. We use heat map for the feature selection.
So you didn't use ranking algorithms, or you didn't use the PCA? Am I right?
We looked at PCA, but we did use just for cumulative variable variance.
Meta?
It's only showing you.
But why didn't you use PCA, for example? Is there a reason for that? Because we use the pre-processing, or we are using these tools for selecting features. If I were you, I would list these features selected by these three different approaches. Then I could come up with a sub-selection of these. Right? Do you understand? For example, ranking selects these features, PCA created these principal components, and blah blah, and then I would combine these, and please turn off your microphone, Hasan. And then you can continue with the combining all these three methods results. Do you follow me?
Mm-hmm. Yes, hocam.
Okay.
So I think, I don't know if you agree with me, but because you are talking about PCN, or you would just summary what happens, what if questions like that. If we select it according to the ranking, the accuracy will be like that. If we selected the PCA, for example, four components, the result would be like that. If we selected this, do you understand? So you would report the options, the results of these selections. Who is the third partner in your group?
İdris hocam.
İdris, so what's your opinion?
Sir, actually, we need to develop this operation according to your suggestions.
Because otherwise, why you are showing these methods to me, if you don't use it? If you don't use them, so it's nonsense, right?
Yeah. You just either eliminate the lowest impact of the
feature. Yeah, I understand, but according to ranking, you selected the five of them. Now the PCA, you are saying that you are inputting all the features for the PCA. Then there is no connection with that in your graph, right?
Yes, hocam, we will.
And then in the heat maps, you are again providing all the features, the original features. And in the end, you are using, talking about that heat map, how you use, you will explain, I believe. But then it is not a good approach like that. There are several approaches you can implement. If I were you, to investigate their impact on the performance, I will use the same model, but the selected features or the generated features could be different according to ranking, PCA, heat map, or another method. Then I would report that according to these three different or four different feature selection algorithms, our result is that the best result with that in training. So I will apply this solution in the testing as well.
Okay.
So yeah. I think you would update your final report accordingly. Okay?
Okay, hocam.
So do you take notes? I don't know, or you will watch this video again, okay?
Mm-hmm. Can watch the video, hocam, on YouTube.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay,
let's and in that kind of presentations, you need to give the justification what happens, why it happens, and how you use it. Okay, let's continue.
Okay. In this part, we use local outlier factor and we find nearly 1,400 outliers, and we drop them from the data set. After the drop process, our sample number decreased to nearly 25,000. In the our data set, there were missing values in 7%. And we filled the empty places from the preprocess tool with random value in the input. Missing value property. As you can see, there is empty places. You need to fill them, and we use random values for that. And in this, we'll move.
Can you drop the missing samples from the data set? How many of them you have in the missing data?
We didn't drop actually, hocam. We just filled them.
I understand you filled in, but I am asking that, do you think that it's a good idea fill with the random values?
Our data set is consist of most of the features 0 and 1, and we use for that random values because, for example, we use average of them, but it is not good approach for 0 and 1 values. So we changed to different approach for that. It's
okay, random. Did you try your model working with these missing data? So what was the accuracy, for example, when you used the original data set with missing values?
You
just handled the missing values. What changed in the performance? Have you monitored this?
No, John, we didn't.
It
we just built and did.
Yes,
do you think that? So, do you think that it's a good idea to compare the performance of the model with the missing data and with the field data?
I think it would be nice to implement the it would be nice to implement because we can understand which process we need to be applied.
Okay, do you think that there are some algorithms they are more susceptible or more prone to error when the data has missing values? Do you know such machine learning algorithms? Do you think that they are much more sensible to the missing data. Or there are some algorithms, do you think that there are some algorithms, they are not affected by these missing data?
I couldn't recall them, sir.
Okay. So Meta?
I don't know, teacher.
Mert?
Hocam, I didn't understand the question. But
so we have several machine learning algorithms, right?
Yes.
And your data has some missing data.
Mm-hmm.
And I am asking that among these machine learning algorithms, do you think that some of them are much more sensible, susceptible, which are much more sensible to missing data? Because some of the machine learning algorithms will not be affected by the missing data, but some of them might be. Do you have any idea about this kind of algorithm and why they are open to this missing data?
In the new Bayes can be used, because they are looking at the features independently, and maybe the missing data are not important. I don't know.
Okay. See, okay, you need to look at this, okay, because you are using some machine learning algorithms in your model. But before that, to check these as an experiment, you need to apply the original data to the same model, and then fill in data. So you updated the missing data with the random values, then to the same model, then you can compare these two results. Then if it works, then you can use the handling the missing data. But if it does not make any changes in the performance, why you would use this? Maybe you are just making more complicated data set because you are putting random values. Do you follow me? Do you understand? So in your final report, please put a simple comparison. The data with missing data, the data with filled in values. And then you compare the performances simply, but the same model, okay?
Okay, hocam, thank you for suggestion. Even today.
Yes, let's continue, please.
It is still continuing here.
Hello, everyone. I'm Idris Taleren from Mechatronics Engineering. In this section of the feature statistics part, we are looking at the statistics of the features because we have already filled the missing values, and also missing values are all zero. As many of the feature samples include zeros and ones, sample and mean value is zero, but max value is one. Therefore, we did not implement normalization operation, as we can see on the graphs. We can go to next slide. In the feature selection part, we have implemented the Pearson correlation to find the features that are most related to our target value. So the first place on the graph feature is the most related with our target, as we can see on the graph. Also, we can see the other features relation accordingly. In the next part, on the feature selection, we were looking for unnecessary features that are needed to be dropped. Accordingly, we have found three features that did not affect in any case, as we shown on the above right hand side. respondent ID, child under 6 months, and health insurance. We can go to next slide.
So Idris, how many features are dropped? Only three?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So the rest, you hold the rest, right?
Yes.
So your feature selection is only, in your feature selection process, you only drop three features. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Then you hold the rest.
And we encode the other variables.
Okay, but for feature selection, you just selected three features to drop, to remove from the data set. Am I right?
Yes, yes, sir.
Why three? Why not 4, 5, 6?
Because they were unnecessary.
How did you decide that they are unnecessary? How did you decide that they are unnecessary? Could you go back one slide? Yeah.
Yes.
How can you decide that these three on the right hand side, right top,
according
they are
to
unnecessary?
Yes, sir. Proportions according to the proportions that is shown us on the graphs with the related features like respondent ID, child under 6 months, and health insurance. It shows the relationship between the target values.
Which scoring algorithm you use, or which according to which function, which scoring algorithms? So you just mentioned in the previous slide, if you go back one more, but you are showing us the Pearson correlation, right?
Yes, yes, sir.
This is scoring, right? So you can find the correlation with different algorithms. Like
yes.
In 5, 6 slides ago, you show us that the ranking algorithms, right? Now you are showing
sir.
One of them. And you said that you just decided to drop three features. Now I am asking that, how can you decide this? I mean, using Pearson correlation, Gini factor, information gain. So which factors do you notice?
We did with the Pearson correlation. Sir.
Why only Pearson correlation?
Because,
why not Gini? Why not?
Because it shows the relations.
All of them shows all these algorithms shows the relationship between the feature and target. All of them, not only Pearson. All of them. All these functions, all these algorithms, gives an idea about the relationship between a feature and the target value.
Yes, sir.
All of them. Not only Pearson, but there are many of them. Why did you use only Pearson, I am asking?
Because it will be quite easy to understand, I think.
Okay. Meta?
I agree with Idris, it's quite easy to understand when we look at this selection.
Mert, İsa?
Hocam, actually we chose the different correlation type, but in the Pearson, it gives us the most effective results.
And then my second question is why only 4 features dropped? Why not 5, 6, 7?
We just eliminate the most low impact of the features.
I understand, but Can you, so here, I cannot see the lowest ones. I cannot read, right?
Okay.
But do you think the fourth one in the bottom, it has better scores than the respondent ID, for example? Far better, or they are close? Do you understand my question? You need to provide some justification why you are using these, why you are not using these. For example, why the Pearson correlation, why not the Gini? Okay, this kind of thing. So you need to be aware of your selections. Otherwise, you are just randomly selecting something and you cannot control the performance of whole model, whole system. Do you understand my point?
Yes, hocam.
Yes, yes.
Otherwise, 4, 5, 6, 7, only Gini, only. So you need an idea why you selected this. Or you need to observe, monitor the impact of the selection. Okay, otherwise it's just, it turns out to be just a random process. I selected these preprocessing, I selected four number of components, I selected the top five features. These are all random selections. And there is no justification. Justification means that not prove something, but give the some basic understanding why you do this. Okay? So in your project, on your final report, please provide this justification. Why did you select this? Or you need to provide the result, the impact of the on the result. You would say we selected this, without this, it is that, with this is the accuracy, for example. Or you would say that we select the, for example, KNN, 3, 4, 5 key values, the results are below, so we selected the key 4. Do you understand my point?
Yes, hocam.
Yes, hocam.
Either you theoretically explain your selection or empirically. Empirical means that do some experiment and show the experiment results. Let's continue.
Okay, hocam. Thank you.
In the encoding part, we encode categorical variables. So according to the this assumption, we did use three tests ordinal. That is in the continuous discrete variables. It converts the value into a single numeric variable. So therefore, it numerates the original values. this means that if data contains categorical data, we need to encode it to numbers before we can fit and evaluate a model. We can go to next slide. Before and after encoding, we encode our 12 categorical values to numeric values. And and treat as ordinal, converts the variable into a single numeric variable, enumerating the original values. In that case, the new variable would have the value of 0 for low and 1 for middle and 2 for high, but it can be edited with domain of the data set. And after encoding operation, we have obtained the numeric values. And also it calls dummy variables. before and after encoding, on the left hand side, it shows the categorical variables. And as I said on the previous slide, after this encoding operation, we have obtained numeric values also.
So So how many features in the end?
27 features are included, sir.
At the beginning, in the original data set, how many features we have after removing 3?
31 feature. There were 31 features, sir.
It is impossible. From 31 to 27, it cannot be. The total feature number is what at the original data set?
At the original data set, there were 31 features.
31 in the original data set. And you remove only 3, right? Then there must be 28.
One of them target feature, hocam.
Okay, so 27 features in the original dataset after removing the last 3 features, right?
Yes, sir.
But then if you convert these categorical features to the continuous features, dummy variables, then there must be more than 27. Am I right?
Use dummy variables, hocam.
Yes, so then, for example, in one categorical feature, maybe there are at least 2 binary categories, so there will be 2 times of this. So it must be around 54 or something minimum. Am I right?
Yes, hocam. But in that feature, it's ordering the...
I understand, but the number of the dummy variables must be larger than the original features. Am I right?
Yes, you are right, hocam.
Yes.
I am asking that what is the final feature number? How many features after continuous the variables, creating the dummy variables? How many features?
We didn't create dummy variables, hocam. We have 27 features.
That's the original number.
Yes,
could you please move on to the next slide? Look here, after encoding, after encoding, you have the many more features. Metan, do you follow me? So what's your answer?
I follow you, but I don't understand what...
For example, look at on the left side. Look at the left side. For one categorical feature, it's written something I cannot read, but you can read me. For example, injured, blah, blah, something. So these values on the left side becomes the feature names on the right side. Am I right? So they are called dummy variables. So the dummy variables are coming from the values in the columns. So if one column has 3 different values, it means that on the resulting encoding, there will be 3 new features.
You are right, hocam. So
I am saying that it cannot be 27 features in the after the encoding. It must be at least 54 features, at least, maybe 70, 90. Depends on the different features in each column. I am repeating my question. After encoding, how many features do you have?
Hocam, thread as ordinal is not creating new feature. In that feature, it's ordering the variables in that starting from zero and...
But you said that you created the dummy variables.
It is incorrect.
I think that's...
Incorrect terminology, hocam.
Yes.
For example,
you just said that you created the... Dummy variables.
Yes, hocam.
Yes.
Correct.
So you didn't create dummy variables. You just encode with the binary values. Am I right?
Yes, hocam. Yes, you create as ordinal for encoding. Not before, dummy variables.
Yes.
For example, in your education.
Yes, hocam. Okay, but there is another method. Maybe you know, right?
Mert? Yes, hocam. You are right. Before we apply your said methods, but we changed this.
Okay, but be careful about what you are talking about. Okay, if you mention the dummy variables means that you are converting and creating new features with the categorical values as a feature name.
Yes, hocam.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry to that.
Okay, let's continue. So what I am suggesting that the number must be changing, but now the numbers are the same, the feature numbers I mean. So I was astonished.
Yes, sir, I understand.
Okay, let's continue.
In proper pre-processing part, we have divided our data set into two regions. As 80% train and 20% test respectively. So we have nearly 19,000 train data and 4,800 test data. As we can see on the bottom left hand side, we take those two options that are replicable sampling and stratified sample, because almost all subsets need to be on the equal class distribution. We can go to next slide. So when we come to the K-neighbors classifier, we have used a number of K-neighbors, which are 3 to 15 increasing by 2. And results were obtained from the test and score widget. We can go to next slide. So as we can see on these two graphs, it shows the train and test accuracy that we used K-neighbors, which are 3 to 15, increasing by 2. It shows the accuracies.
So Idris, according to these results, how can you comment on the value of K?
Sir, I think when number of neighbors is increasing, accuracy for train dataset decreases. And on the other hand, we can say when the number of neighbor is increasing, accuracy for the test dataset is coming closer and increasing, sir, respectively.
Meta, if you would like to comment on these results, what would you say about the value of K and the results?
If we increase the K value, train accuracies increase, but test accuracies decrease because...
Or vice versa, or opposite.
Because there will or be...
Do you notice what you are saying and what is on the graph? I think you are saying conversely. In train, it looks like that when you increase the key value, the train accuracy is dropping.
Yes, in this table, according to this table.
Yes, according to these results, yes. What you can, what you would comment?
I think
mm. What about Mert? Mert,
hocam, I guess
what would you comment?
I think this underfitting hocam.
Underfitting?
Look at the graph.
Well, there is, I am not talking about underfitting, overfitting, but I am saying that or asking that what would you comment on these results? So
okay,
the relationship between the K value and the accuracy.
Okay, when we increase the K numbers in the training, accuracy is decreasing, but in the train part, in the test part, the model accuracy is increasing.
Why? Do you have an idea? Or do you expect that result?
I don't.
Meta?
I don't know.
But, okay. For me, actually, as far as I see in these graphs, the changing the key value didn't impact the accuracy very much. I think so. Right? It looks like random.
Yes.
Do you agree? It researches, yes. I think so, because I think it's just a random changes, but we observed, I believe. Okay. So okay. I think you apply some other things to improve your performance, I believe. Let's continue.
Yes, we try to do.
Yes. Yes, sir.
When applying logistic regression, we have two different regularization types. One of them is rich and the other is lasso. Since rich and lasso values are hyperparameter, we try this with different values. Next. In this table, you can see different lasso C values. When we reduce the C values in both lasso and rich regularization type, the learning capacity of the model decreases. Next. On the other hand, even when we increase the value of C excessively, there is no change. We can understand from here that logistic regression is not a suitable type for our data type. Next. It's a different rich values.
How would you comment on this result?
I think it is not for our data sets.
Mert İhsan, how would you comment on this result? So you change the capacity of the network.
For example,
or complexity, but the results looks like steady.
Yes, in the 0.100, results are same. It doesn't change anything.
So how would you comment this? We see this, but how would you comment? Give some insight for us, thinking about the rich regularization.
Okay.
Idris,
I guess.
Sure. I couldn't make any assumption.
I would think that even with very low C values, the model has very large complexity so that it can solve this problem. Even increasing the capacity with higher values like 1000, it wouldn't learn more. So with very low severity, it already learned about your data. And if you remember that, these results are very similar to KNN results. Am I right?
Yes, hocam.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Very similar, right? Between 0.75 and 8, right? They are.
Yes.
75% 8. Yes. So I mean that this SVM, is that right? Is it the SVM?
No.
So logistic regression. So the logistic regression already similar results with KNN. So it is also insensible to the change of C value in rich and loss zone. Am I right?
Yes, you are right.
Yes, yes, sir.
So it means that this data set is easy data set for itself, but it cannot learn more than that. I will comment like this. Okay, let's continue.
In the naive bias train and test section, classification accuracy generalized can be considered. The part where the full slope is in the curve part of the graph is in this section, I think we was think about it's a generalized, but according to your comments, it's a underfitting.
Also note that this is very similar results with the previous two methods.
Yes, yes.
Yes, hocam. Long
practice, so... okay, let's go.
Next.
Hi, everyone. I'm Mert İhsan. I will talk about random forest models and SVM models. And finally, the last model we decide on. Here, we set the number of features to 5 in each discipline and set the replicable part to true always, get the same result. We try to find the best result by trying the number of trees with our hyperparameter in different numbers. We try to tune it with 9 different tree numbers. For example, we start from 10 to the number of 15 trees. As you can see, classification accuracy is around 94 in the train result, but this rate is decreases to 76 in the test part. The model is overfitting very clearly. In the SVM model, we try to tune it by changing the cost value, which is our hyperparameter, and using the autogamma. We have tuned it with different seven different cost numbers values. We have found that low cost values give more effective results, as you can see in here. But the success rate of model is very low. As shown in the graph, the accuracy value decreases when the cost value increases. In the final model selection, finally, as part of our decision to select the model, we analyze our metrics and compare them to accuracy value. We choose the random forest model as the final model since it gave more effective results. But it's overfitting. Thank you for listening. Do you have any question, hocam?
Yes, I do. Go one back slide.
Okay.
Yes. So if you look at this, except the SVM, all the other methods provide almost similar results, right?
Yes, hocam.
Very similar. So in that case, what would you do to increase the test accuracy? Meta?
Can I get a question?
Okay, I will repeat the question. If you look at this graph, Okay. Except SVM method, the rest of the models provides almost the same or similar test accuracy. How would you increase test accuracy? What would you do to increase the test accuracy? If all these models, the four or five models, produce similar results. So what would you think?
Hocam, we need to do pre-processing techniques again. Maybe we can eliminate more features or the other
features.
We can change property of data sets. Maybe we can add a new features or deletes, maybe other features.
Idris?
Sir, we can try again the pre-processing methods to improve the model.
For example, we can use the continuous
discrete variables widgets by trying some methods within this section, but also maybe we can scale the features more.
But there is no numeric values. I believe there is no real number values. You have mostly 27 categorical values. You cannot scale the categorical values. Am I right?
I'm sorry. I say incorrect.
Okay. So anyone has an idea, specific idea for your data set, specific, very specific. I can do this and try to see the impact. Maybe it would help. So do you have any specific idea?
Hocam, in the future selection part, maybe we can choose more related features again. We are as your suggestions. Maybe
like we can drop specific. Do you think that dropping some features will increase the results?
I don't know. We need to check it.
Okay, check in the final report. And others, okay. Do you have any specific thing to do? For example, I would do the simple one is, I will just implement the PCA with three or four components covering the explainability maybe 80%. And then I would try this. Or then I can combine the PCAs and the features together to increase the number of the features. Or I can use the dummy variables because I know that the linear models likes high dimensional data. Am I right? So I would like to increase the number of the features. How I can do this? By creating dummy variables. You can do this instead of just converting to categorical values. I would create the dummy variables. And maybe I would handle the missing data differently. Okay, these are the things that I would like to do. Otherwise, in that model, I would see that you just try the models with different parameters, but you couldn't make any improvement in the results. Am I right?
You are right, hocam.
Okay, so in your final report, just add this one as well. After that point, you just try some of the improvements and report these improvements as well.
Okay, hocam.
Or because you have the same pipeline, you just change the pre-processing layers. Okay.
Okay, hocam.
Okay, sir.
Anything you would like to add?
You can show the orange tree part, hocam, as you.
Yes, okay. But shortly we have over 1 hour already.
Okay,
if it is gonna be very quick, yes.
Would you see?
Yes.
We split the data set into two parts. Actually, it is train labels part, 0 and 1 seasonal vaccines. This comes from it's train data frame. We merge them and we select columns. We use outlier factors. Here pre-process part, input the missing values, quantize discrete variable as threat as ordinal. We look feature statistics, heat map, correlation, PCA, rank, and use data center for splitting the train and test data frame. We use SVM, KNN, Rich Lasso, and random forest naive bias for model selection in different hyperparameters. That's all, John.
Okay. So as I mentioned in the beginning of the slides, for example, for the PCA, you see that you can connect the PCA and use the results in your final report, or you can select the PCA plus the original ones and then try again. You understand my point? So you can use these graph workflow again. All right. So do you have any questions for me?
No, hocam. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, sir.
So I hope that you would improve your final report. Okay, in 2 weeks' time. All right. Okay. Thank you for your effort. It has been a good project for me. You understand how to use the machine learning algorithms, I believe. You understand the parameters, hyperparameters, and the whole process, training and testing process, and then commenting on the results, I hope. So I would like to see a better final report from your team.
Okay, hocam. Okay,
thank you.
We will do that.
Thank you
for everything.
Thank you.
Thank you.